Yesterday, the ZR1 dropped. The Corvette ZR1 dropped. It was July 25th, and it dropped at 7:30 p.m. We did some videos on it. We covered it. And in today's video, what I want to do is I want to get into the engine, the famous LT7 5.5 liter V8, making 1,064 horsepower and 828 feet-pound of torque. Now, we've all been anticipating this vehicle. We've all been waiting for this vehicle, and Chevy didn't disappoint us, because we've been seeing the EV push tremendously when it comes to the automotive world. And to see a 1,064 horsepower twin turbo V8, it is what we guys were asking for. Now, we have the all-wheel drive Corvette, that is the E-Ray Corvette, and it is a pretty sick Corvette, and it's pretty fast. I'm not 100% against EV, but we gas guys, we need that power. You know, hot rodding is hot rodding. It doesn't matter how much the government is trying to put the EV, how much EVs are trying to get pushed out. Hot rodding is hot rodding. Hot rodding is crazy paint, crazy loud, big power, big muscle, big engines, and that's what we wanted. So we got it in today's video. So the LT7 is here, and I wanted to go over the engine. 5.5 liter V8, 1,064 horsepower, 828 feet-pound of torque. Now, there are a lot of articles, and there are some things that we wanted to cover up. So one of the things that Chevrolet said, that the dyno that they had, the engine was pretty much making so much power that they had dynos that were not significantly being able to hold the power, to handle the power. So they had to buy two new dynos that were rated for 1,000 horsepower in order to continue moving on to this vehicle. Now, this is some of the article that some of the chief engineers from Chevy said, and we're going to go over some of the details of the engine so we can know exactly what is going on with this engine and all the details on the engine. So the danger of overreaching on the power is that you overtax the vehicle. Absolutely. When it comes to the cooling, when it comes to pretty much everything, the transmission and the drive shaft, and they go on to covering it. Is the cooling system designed to handle the power? We want to make sure that we don't break a transmission, that we don't break the half shaft. So we have to run more analysts and more validation tests to make sure it's up to the challenge. Now, you have to remember that the Dodge Demon breaks 1,025 horsepower on E85, and Chevrolet was chasing the dream of, they wanted to do 1,026, but on pump gas. They wanted to do that extra horsepower, but on pump gas. So the article goes on to say the calibration engineers were in the dyno and were taking, and they were starting to make some runs. Then the dyno wasn't happy. That's what I said, that they had to buy two dynos, and they had to pretty much buy two dynos that were rated at 1,000 horsepower in order to continue. The fact that you were able to make 1,064 horsepower and not being on E85 with a twin turbo V8, it is an amazing deal. Now, you have to remember that it does use a flat plane crankshaft. It is a low compression engine, and it's powered by the twin turbo, which pretty much has no turbo lag. So the C6 and the C7 generation CR1s made 638 horsepower and 755 horsepower, respectively, using a supercharger on the 6.2 liter V8. I would have thought that maybe if they were going for bigger power, I would have thought to myself, Chevy's going big displacement, 6.2, obviously, no. It's a smaller displacement, lower compression in order to handle the twin turbo. So it would have been reasonable to assume the C8 would follow the suit, absolutely, with a belt-driven blower. But if you bolt on a supercharger to a lightweight crank train of a flat plane V8, you no longer have a lightweight crank train. The fast revving character of the engine would have been lost. But also, if you put a supercharger in it, you're losing a lot of space, and the turbochargers make it more efficient. One, in terms of fuel economy, and other, in terms of squeezing more power given the amount of fuel and air ratio. But if you put two turbos, gives you more space in the engine to work. The article goes to say that a supercharger uses a portion of the engine's power to overcome the friction of the blowers. Turbos don't pay the same penalty, which is one of the reasons the ZR1's LT7 can make more power in the dyno than the Dodge Challenger SRT Demon with less displacement. I said it on yesterday's video that this car was going to break everything on its category. It is a 200 plus mile per hour vehicle. Now, I want to get into these smaller videos here. So the twin turbo supercharger, how do you make even more powerful? The ZR1 engineers were tasked with that mission. Charge air coolers paired with a dual mono scroll ball bearing turbos working together to deliver an an immense amount of power. Along with the integrated exhaust manifold, the turbos provide the quick responsive you expect. Electronically controlled wastegate combined with other engines control virtually eliminate turbo lag. And that's one of the things we are super happy about, especially during more dynamic driving situations. To sum it up, you get more power in less time and massive torque output out the gate, and it's pretty much a mission complete. Now, one of the things that I thought to myself was, the ZR1 is coming out, it's gonna be a turbo engine, but I thought to myself that Chevy would integrate some sort of electric motor into it, whether it was gonna be a small kilowatt per hour motor that would be squeezed between the transmission and the engine to make that extra power, but they didn't. It is a complete combustible engine, twin turbo V8. But then again, we also have the E-Ray Corvette, which is another beast of a car. And I would have thought for sure that they would have been doing that. Now, when we move on to the intake, completely unique to the LT7, the Edge Blue intake system brings air from the charged air coolers into the engine, the engine's intake manifold, where it's mixed with fuel from two systems, the port and direct injection, PDI. The cool air and fuel mixtures are then sent into the combustion chamber where it ignites and drives the never-ending torque, pretty much preparing to fly. It's in other words, we're reaching cooling. They want to cool the motor. They want to push as much charge air as they can. This motor is insane. Now, head and valve train. The goal was to take the power and performance to the next level. That goal was achieved with the LT7 engine. Remember, you got to remember that this engine started getting produced back in 2014, meaning when they started working on it, putting things together, it was back in 2014 when it started coming into, not being put together, but when the idea came into to the table. A unique cylinder head casting with updated combustion chamber works, I apologize guys, the camera cut off, works with the intake system to help increase airflow, reduce compression, while the exhaust port enables and optimizes turbocharging system. The valve train was redefined for boost. You have to performance to bring the powerful output you expect. It is more than an engine. This system knows the difference between just moving and making power on the move. Now, with the crank train, remember we have a flat plane crank. The crank train supports extra force as it converts pressure into torque and horsepower. The flat plane crankshaft is the backbone that holds it all together, allowing interaction with other engine parts, such as the stronger forged piston. Because it does have forged pistons, the wrist pin is bigger, thicker, and stronger forged titanium rods. The piston converts the energy released during the combustion into mechanical work, and it reacts against the titanium rod. Every part has a purpose, because when it comes to achieving power, it doesn't happen alone. Of course, everything has to be put together, and everything has to work 100% in order for this car to make the 1,064 horsepower. Now, one of the main things that I like about this engine, that there is no turbo lag. You have a low displacement engine, 5.5 compared to the other ones. You add a turbo on it, but not only do you add the turbo on it, but you make it low compression. It brings you a ton of power. But anyways, that's what we have. You know, I wanted to show you guys this graph right here, which is the dyno sheet. And in the dyno sheet, we can see that from 3,000 RPMs to 6,000 RPMs, we're making an immense amount of torque. This car is a torque monster. Even though it has 824, it is a torque monster. I cannot wait to see this vehicle put against other vehicles, going to the track, drag racing, going against other vehicles. And I wanted to see it going against the Lucid EV, which is pretty much putting a whooping on everything that's out there. But I wanted to see that. I wanted to see that the Corvette ZR1 against that. So is it really a small block V8? Let's see what the article has to say. With a dual overhead camshaft, two turbos, and a flat plane crankshaft, you might be wondering if the LT7 has or really has any rights to be the iconic Chevy small block name. The technology marveling and powering the ZR1 has as much as common as with the 1955 Corvette 4.3 liter V8 as your phone shares. With your grandma's Ray tube cabinet television, we'll simply say that the LT6 has the same 4.4 inch bore spacing as the original Chevy small block V8, and it's kind of like, leave it up to you to decide. Well, I think it really does. I think it really does. I think there is a combination in displacement from the old school technology, and you bring it on to this new technology, you get these twin turbos in there, and it is amazing, and you created a vehicle. Now, is this the end of something, or is it the beginning of something for Chevy? Because we don't know what the next year one's going to bring. And with this whole EV thing, I think Chevy's making a statement with this vehicle saying gas is going nowhere. We're here to stay. And this Corvette is here with a lot of power. And this is the road that we're going towards. Now, with the whole EV thing, I think they were very smart, because they said, we'll add the all-wheel drive E-Ray. And you have that choice. But then you have the 0-1 full combustion, full turbo, all the works, all the tweaks. It's making that much horsepower. So my question to you guys, is it the end of something, or is it the beginning of something? If you guys are enjoying the content, remember to subscribe, comment, and hit the thumbs up so YouTube can start pushing this channel more. Like I said, some of these videos have been, for some reason, I feel like they're even shadow banned, and YouTube is throwing them in the dark. I'll see you guys on the next. Remember to tune in and subscribe. Your boy is out of here.